I think I have this on. Good morning, South Fork.
Good morning.
Hey, good to see everyone. Those of you who are watching at home, welcome to our worship service. And, you know, this is one of those days where in the second week of November, how many days could we actually go outside and worship? And it would be comfortable and gorgeous and all that kind of stuff. God has just given us a great day to celebrate today. So I'm going to ask you to just kind of just, it's been a busy week, okay? I mean, there's a lot of stuff that's going on, a lot of media stuff. If you can, just kind of push that aside, okay? And let's just really focus today on the God who hasn't changed and Jesus Christ who is still our King. And so this is going to be kind of a special service today. There's going to be some different elements that we're going to share with you. I hope you can benefit from those as well. And an announcement at the end of the service as well. So let me just start with a word of prayer, and then the worship team will take over. And let me just warn you this. The first song, okay, do some breathing exercises while I'm praying, okay? It talks about how God is good, but it's very up-tempo, and you're going to have to keep up. Okay, that's all I got to say. Let's pray. God, thank you for a gorgeous day that we can come here today and to worship you. God, I pray that now our focus would be on you, that you would have all of our attention, and that, God, you would receive from us an offering that just smells good, looks good, and feels good to you. God, bless this time as we seek to bless you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
You'll probably have to help the team keep the air going here today. So we're going to sing God is Good all the time.
Except for we have no sound.
Jim, we can't hear it.
All you
ladies. Here we go.
God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart of mine. God is good all the time. Through the darkest night, his light will shine. God is good. God is good all the time. God is good all the time. He put a song of praise in this heart.
Thank you. We kept up pretty good. And because God is so good, we know we can lean on him through anything. So we're going to lean on the everlasting arms.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near. Leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives. Amen, amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, every fear is gone. I know he holds my life, my future in his hands.
Be singing our song now to prepare us for our time of communion. And we're singing a very appropriate song, I Come to the Cross. It was at the cross that Christ gave up his life for us. And after this song, we'll have our meditation and our time of communion.
I They come to the cross seeking mercy and grace. I come to the cross where you died in my place. Out of my weakness and into your strength, humbly I come to the cross. Your arms are open, you call me by name. You welcome the child that was lost. You paid the price for my guilt and my shame. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come to the cross.
Forgot something. Good morning. If I was to ask you what the definition of healing is, I think I'd get many different answers. There are just so many opinions on what healing does and what it means. There's physical healing. That's where if you broke a bone, you know, it'll heal in a few weeks. And if you have a small wound, it usually heals in a few days. If you get sick, sometimes it takes longer to heal. Then there's emotional healing. These are wounds of the heart. This is where you may have lost a loved one or you're going through a divorce. Then there's spiritual healing. This is when you ask God for forgiveness or God answers your prayers. Some wounds never heal and they're just too deep. Jesus suffered so many wounds for us. Pilate ordered him to be flogged and he had to carry his own cross. They pressed a crown of thorns on his head. They nailed his hands and feet to a cross. They even pierced his side with a spear. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Then Jesus was healed in 3 days. In 1 Peter 2:24, it says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. Will you join me as we take communion together? This juice represents Jesus' blood that cleanses us from our sins. The bread we take reminds us that Jesus took the wounds of our sins so that we could be healed. Dear Heavenly Father, you suffered every wound that a human could endure. You were stripped, you were humiliated, you were mocked. You were even spit on. Yet you took all this punishment with us to the cross. Only you can heal our wounds, and on the cross you did that so willingly. And the cup and juice we just took helps us to remember your healing grace. And we can't thank you enough for this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the one who breaks the darkness with a liberating light. Praise the one who frees the prisoners, turning blindness into sight. Praise the one who preached the gospel, healing every dread disease, calming storms and feeding thousands with the very bread of peace. Praise the one who blessed the children with a strong yet gentle word. Praise the one who drove out demons with a piercing two-edged sword. Praise the one who brings cool water to the desert's burning sand. From this well comes living water, quenching thirst in every land.
Has anyone else noticed a decrease in the volume of mail that you've received since Tuesday? I mean, for a while there, we were getting multiple pieces of mail every day about some congressional race or about some tax they wanted to put on the state fair. Is that right? Did that include county fairs that they wanted to tax? It's a joke, guys, okay? I'm just glad it's over, okay? I'm glad that we survived another election year, and I'm convinced we're going to hear about it for some time into the future. But the best news is that God hasn't changed, has he? Jesus is still the leader of all of us who have chosen to follow him, and that's whether that's here or all around the globe. I think more than once I stopped this past week and just said, you know, thank you, God, for letting Jesus still be on the throne and for his lordship. And I've also tried to do my best, like I'm sure you have as well, to make sure that when you sit down to eat, that you pause for just a moment and you try to mention one of those kernels of thanksgiving that we're doing for the month of November. Last week, I mentioned to you about how back in 1621, the early settlers here in America faced a very difficult fall and winter. And the story goes that there was such a scarcity of food that each person was given a daily ration of just 5 kernels of corn. There's a poem written by a guy named Hezekiah Butterworth that was entitled The 5 Kernels of Corn. And what he did in that poem was he talked about how hard life was for those early settlers, but also how much they still had to be thankful for. And so at least in the Northeast, a tradition broke out where at the Thanksgiving meal, there were 5 kernels of corn that was placed at each place setting. And before anyone could take a bite out of their Thanksgiving feast, everybody had to go around the table, and they had to name 5 things that they were thankful for. You know, last week we made available these little bags that had 5 kernels of corn in them with this little tag on it that is just kind of a reminder. And I ask you to put it wherever you eat the most and then have it as a visual reminder that before you take that first bite, okay, that you just take a moment and say thanks to God for at least one thing. Now, if you're an overachiever and you want to do 5 every meal, that's fine, okay? That's totally up to you. But if you could, just remember to do that. If you weren't here last week, we have some more bags that you can take home with you today. For those of you who are watching at home, we'll try to mail those to you this week so that you can be a part of this exercise for the month of November. Even with all this going on in the world, today, I think there are still so many things that we have to be thankful for. And to jumpstart the process, we're looking at Psalm 103, where David the psalmist encourages us to bless God by listing some of the benefits that he has given to us. And this month, what I've said is I want to equate the benefits that he lists in Psalm 103 to 5 kernels of thanksgiving that I'm asking you thanks for during this month. Last about the incredible blessing of forgiveness and the impact that that has on all of our lives. Not just the fact that we've been forgiven by God, which we just celebrated through the Lord's Supper, but the freedom that we have when we actually forgive someone else who has sinned against us. I really pray, okay, if this is something that you've struggled with, maybe there's a person in your life that this past week you took a couple of moments and you just kind of wrestled with this whole issue of forgiveness. And if you were holding on, okay, maybe to a grudge or to something, that you were able to just kind of let go of that and to forgive them, because truly, forgiveness does set us free. Today, what I want to do is to focus our attention on the second kernel of thanksgiving in Psalm 103. And so I want to read the first five verses of 103 again. I told you by the end of the month, you'll probably have it memorized, but I'm going to change it up a little bit in that last week I read from the NIV. Today, I want to read from the New Living Translation. And what I want you to do is I want you to notice the change, okay? How the wording is changed and the impact that it has on us being able to apply this particular psalm. So let's look at Psalm 103, verse 1. Let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart, I will praise his holy name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things that he does for me. Good things being the benefits that we talked about last week. He forgives all my sins and heals all of my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and mercies. He fills my life with good things, and my youth is renewed like the eagles. What is different about the New Living Translation compared to the NIV? What it is that they personalize the pronoun. Instead of saying he forgives all of your or your diseases, he says he forgives all of my diseases. It's me and my instead of you and yours. Now, technically, both are probably okay. Maybe to the original Hebrew, the you and yours is maybe a little more accurate. But you know what? When it comes to translating those verses into my life and applying them to my life, I really like the personal pronouns. I like the fact of being able to say, God, you heal all of my diseases. You forgive all of my sins. Because when I think of it that way, I have a lot more reasons to be thankful. The second level of thanksgiving is that of healing. And David says that he heals all of my diseases. You know, we're in the middle of a pandemic and a time when the practice of medicine, we hear about it in the daily news. I just thought it would be really good for us to hear from one of our healthcare workers here at South Fork, Stacy Wieland. And you know what? There's signs all over the place that says hearts to healthcare workers, okay? And we really do need to be very appreciative of what they're doing for us to keep us healthy and going. But today I'm going to invite Stacy to come up, and I'm just going to ask her a few questions about her role in the healthcare community. And what I'd like for you to do is, could we just show some appreciation to Stacy as she comes forward and we talk with her today? Thank you, Ben.
Struggling a little bit.
We made it. There you go. Stacy, thank you so much for being willing to share today, but thank you also for all that you do, okay? I know that you put in a lot of hours and a lot of hard work just trying to keep people safe and healthy. Your role is as a nurse practitioner, is that correct?
Yes.
What does a nurse practitioner do?
Yeah, so a nurse practitioner is a registered nurse that earns their master's or doctorate's degree in advanced practice nursing, so they have more education, clinical training, and taking care of patients in primary care, so they could diagnose, treat, and even prescribe medications. So they can, that's how they're different from like a registered nurse.
Okay.
So
it's kind of like a doctor, but you don't make as much money, right?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah. And less schooling.
Debt probably to go with
yes,
that.
Exactly.
So why did you want to become a nurse practitioner?
I love taking care of patients. I love the medical field. I love learning about medicine. And then I love primary care because I really develop a relationship with my patients, and I kind of get to see them go through like the whole life process as a child and then as an adult. So, yeah.
You've been doing it for how long now?
A little over a year.
Yeah. That's just awesome. And what a time to start.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
Lots of exciting things taking place in the world of medicine. Stacy, you have the ability to again get connected with your patients, and so part of your job is to kind of diagnose what's going on in their life
and then chart a course of treatment, okay? Some path that will either make them healthy or keep them healthy. Is that correct?
Yes.
How does it feel, okay, when somebody comes to you and maybe they're struggling with something, they have a health issue, and you're able to diagnose that, plan a course of treatment, and it works? How does that make you feel?
Yeah, I mean, it feels really great. And not only that, I think when the patients come in, they feel a little bit more at ease, too, because they're looking for an answer. I had a patient that came in, had some respiratory issues, and I was able to diagnose lung cancer, but he had a good outcome, though. So he comes in, he's very thankful every time he sees me, and I feel thankful when I see him. He's alive and he's doing well, so yeah.
So it just kind of makes you feel great.
Yeah, it reminds me why I'm in this profession.
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
So.
But let's go to the flip side of that, okay?
Yeah.
Because not all stories end that way.
Exactly, yeah.
Somebody comes in, you diagnose them correctly, you do the normal treatment, you do everything according to protocols, and yet that person dies.
Mm-hmm.
How does that make you feel?
It's hard. I mean, you think about them, you know. I mean, I had a patient, she didn't pass away, but she had a very poor prognosis, and she probably has a few more years to live. But that was it's hard to take that in. I think about her, you know, I pray about her, but we just kind of make them feel comfortable in any way that we can. But you kind of have to move on in a way where you can't just dwell on it, because then it kind of affects your care on other patients that you're taking care of.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's always something that I've thought, you know, for those in the medical field who have that responsibility and that load, that would be so hard, you know, to carry that. And to be honest, I don't know how people who don't have faith, mm-hmm. you know, can really see, you know, to go through that and stuff. So, Stacy, yeah, this is a tough time. Okay, and how can we best pray for you, the people that you work with, and everybody in the medical profession? Tell us firsthand, how can we pray?
I think just fear. I mean, I think a lot of people are fearful with what's going on, but I try to tell my patients every day, you know, try to stay away from the news as much as you can. but even
that's
like...
That's a really good prescription.
I know. But even as, you know, providers and anyone in the healthcare profession, I think everybody's kind of fearful with what's going on. But, in that way, I guess, and just making sure that, you know, our focus is on the patient and that we could provide that good care to them and not let that interfere with our practice. So, yeah.
Well, can we pray for you
today?
Okay. And would you join me in praying for Stacy and all of the other healthcare workers who are doing exactly what she said she's been faced with? So let's pray. God, I thank you for people like Stacy who you've given the mental ability, the intelligence to be able to learn, to be able to study science and to be able to study the human body and to be able to match those two and provide opportunities for the rest of us to live a healthier life. So God, first of all, we say thank you and indeed our hearts do go out to those who labor each and every day to just keep us safe and to keep us healthy. Father, we are in a time where fear is so prevalent, and Father, I'm convinced probably even in the medical profession there's fear of the unknown and fear of just not knowing how all of this pandemic is going to turn out and what really needs to happen. And so, God, I pray that you would just calm those fears and those who lead us through this. And that, God, you would then calm our fears as we see their faith. And, Father, I pray that faith is in you. God, may the attention of every healthcare provider today be on the patient that is before them. And, Father, may there be an acknowledgement that, Father, they work with you and that you are indeed the great physician who heals in so many different ways. Father, thank you for all who serve today in the medical field. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Stacy,
thank you
so much. Let's say thank you again. Give you that. You
You know, while on earth, Jesus really catapulted the whole world of medicine to a whole new level. And what we read in the Gospels, I think, is just a little bit of what Jesus did here on earth. So I want to look at a number of passages today, just out of the Gospel of Matthew alone, okay? We'll go through them fairly quickly. You can make a note of them. They're in the program this morning. But I want you just to hear what was so important to Jesus throughout his ministry. Matthew chapter 4, verse 23 is where we're going to start. It says, Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in the synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News about him spread all over Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. Matthew chapter 8, verse 14. When Jesus came to Peter's house, he saw Peter's mother-in-law lying in bed with a fever, and he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she got up and began to wait on him. When evening came, many who were demon-possessed were brought to him, and he drove out the spirits with a word, and healed all the sick. This was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. He took upon our infirmities and carried our diseases. Matthew chapter 9, verse 35. Jesus went throughout all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into the harvest field." And then in chapter 10, verse 1, listen to what he says. He called his 12 disciples to him and gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. Matthew chapter 12, verse 15. Aware of this, Jesus withdrew from that place, but many followed him, and he healed all of their sick. Matthew chapter 14, verse 34. When they had crossed over, they landed at Gennesaret, and when a man at that place recognized Jesus, they sent word out to all of the surrounding country. And people brought all of their sick to him and begged him to let the sick just touch the edge of his cloak. And all who touched him were healed. Matthew chapter 21, verse 14. The blind and the lame came to him at the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw this wonderful things that he did, and the children shouting in the temple area, "Hosanna to the Son of God," they were indignant. Those are just a few of the passages in the Gospels that talk about Jesus' ministry of healing. And Luke, being a physician, if you read his account, he'll even go into more detail about some of the same healings that I just read out of Matthew's Gospel. You know, when Jesus came to earth, he definitely came to address men's spiritual needs, but we cannot deny, nor can we ignore, how much he focused on the physical needs and healing in his ministry. You know, if you go back and look closely at the history of medicine, what you're going to see is that Jesus had a huge impact on the practice of medicine and healthcare, even as we know it today. Some would even say that if it weren't for the followers of Jesus, we probably wouldn't have the level of healthcare that we have today. This past week, I found a very interesting article in the Christian Medical Fellowship's website from the UK entitled "The Christian Contribution to Medicine." I'm going to encourage you to look at that. So I gave you the website address on the screen. It's in the program. And in this passage, the author suggests that it was perhaps the words that Jesus gave, and more than his healings themselves, that impacted Christians' contributions to medicine. Because in Matthew chapter 25, verse 40, it says this: "Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me." You know, many point to what the early church did as they looked after widows and orphans to really be a catalyst for what we know as hospitals today. And really, taking care of those who are in need, especially physically, has always been a trademark of Christianity. I want to just talk a few of the highlights out of this article. And again, it's a very long article. I encourage you to read it. But he talks about how it was the Christians of the Roman Empire who really began to change society's attitude towards the sick, the disabled, and the dying by their radically different outlook in life. Because the Greco-Roman world in which Christianity appeared was often very cruel and inhumane to those who were sick. The weak and the sick were despised. There were abortions and infanticide and poisonings were widely practiced. In fact, doctors back then were oftentimes sorcerers who also had the ability maybe to heal, but more than that, had the ability to kill. It wasn't until Constantine granted the first edict of toleration in AD 311 that Christians were really able to give public expression to their ethical convictions and undertake some social reforms when it came to those who were in need of health care. In fact, stories of Christians caring had enormous impact even before Constantine made his decree, because Clement, a Christian leader in Rome at the end of the first century, records how the Christian community was already doing much to relieve the plight of the poor widows. In the second century, when the plague hit the city of Carthage, pagan households just threw those suffering out into the streets. And the entire Christian community, led by their bishop, responded by going into the streets to care for those people as they lay in the streets and oftentimes taking them into their very homes. Christianity is credited as having a huge impact on the whole development of medical ethics because of the value that Jesus placed on lives. Not to mention the care of the elderly. And even surgical procedures were affected by Christians. On more than one occasion, it was a clergy member who led the way in the development of some new medical practice or procedure. So that's led me to believe this, okay? I'm going to start a new dimension to our ministry here at South Fork. I'm going to start doing surgeries at night, okay? I can do them much cheaper, and we have lots of space in the building that we're not using during the pandemic, okay? So I figure we can just convert those over, and I can moonlight as a surgeon, okay? Because if they could do it back in the 1600s, 1700s, I can surely do it, right? Okay. For those of you who don't know me, I'm kidding, okay? I'm going to leave the healthcare to Stacy and a lot of other smart people to do those things, okay? But I just found that article fascinating about how much influence followers of Christ have had in the healing of people to this very day. That said, though, let's get back to Psalm 103. I think we have reason to be thankful for the healing that God gives us for those who work in the medical profession, but yet I wrestle. I don't know about you, but I wrestle with David's words when he says, God heals all of my or your diseases. I don't know that I believe that. Because if you look at David's life, after David sinned with Bathsheba, they had a child that was born, and he was stricken with some sort of illness that for 7 days, David poured his heart out to God asking, please heal my son, and God didn't. The son died. He forgave David of his sin, but he didn't heal his child's disease. So how could David write, God, you heal all of my diseases? I think back to when my sister Anita was fighting her cancer, and we all prayed more times than we can count for God to heal her of this disease. And there were periods of time where it seemed like he was answering them in the way that we wanted him to, but then she would go for another test, and we would find out that the cancer had spread. I'll never forget the day that Denise called me. Anita was going to have surgery to remove the cancer from her esophagus. And when they opened her up, they noticed that the cancer had spread to other parts of her upper body. And so all they could do was to close the wound and say, there's nothing else that we can do. We went into the surgery thinking that God was going to use surgeons to heal our sister. And yet we came out of there with disappointment. He didn't do what he said. I'm sure I wasn't the only one who had difficult conversations with God during that time period where I cried out, why? To this day, there are still times
that I pray and I say, God, why? And you know what? The only answer that I've ever received from him is a verse out of the book of Isaiah, chapter 55, verse 8. And I've learned to hold on really, really tight to this verse because it says this. This is God speaking, and he says, my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. How could it be that God did not want to heal my sister? I thought he was a great physician. I thought he was the great healer. I thought healers heal. But he didn't this time. The way I wanted things to work out was for the cancer to be taken out of her physical body, but it only continued to grow. My way was obviously not his way. My guess is I'm not the only person listening to this sermon who wrestles with this issue. And I don't know about you, but in my mind, I have to come to some form of resolution. I have to be able to understand, what is David talking about in the second part of Psalm 103, verse 3, when he says, God, you heal all of my diseases. I've come to the conclusion that sometimes healing isn't a part of this life. It will come in the next life. And passages like 1 Corinthians 15 and Revelation 21 just kind of help me get my arms around that a little bit better. Look at a couple verses out of 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 53. Paul says this, for the perishable must clothe itself with the imperishable, and the mortal with immortality. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. And Revelation chapter 21, verse 3. Can't tell you how many times I've used this sitting by the bed of somebody in the hospital who's dying or talking with a family member who has a family member who's suffering. John says, and I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, now the dwelling of God is with men, and he will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. For the old order of things, key phrase, the old order of things has passed away. I guess the old order of things was that our physical bodies contract diseases and they don't work the way that they should. But in heaven, there's a whole new order where our bodies are imperishable and not susceptible to pain, illnesses, or pandemics. Our bodies are healed. I guess what David said, because he was a follower of God, is true, and that is that God does heal all of our diseases, does he not? It's just sometimes he'll do it here and now. And other times, it's not going to happen until we receive that new body with no physical limitations. When he chooses not to heal someone here on earth, what it does is it creates separation and it creates turmoil and struggles, and that stinks. There's no question about it. But you know what? That's when faith has to come in. David was a man of faith when he wrote those words. We are people of faith who believe that our knowledge of who God is and our trust of him must override those feelings. So that brings us back to the challenge, where we try to find reasons for Thanksgiving this November. And I'm going to suggest that truly the fact that God heals us, whether it be here or there, is a reason and a kernel of thanksgiving. So I encourage you this week to think about, how has God healed you? How has he used people like Stacy or your other physicians or people in the medical field? How has he worked with them to bring healing to your body? At the same time, think about those who weren't healed. Those who maybe we wanted to go one way, but God's way was a different way. And when we see them again, we will see them with bodies that aren't deformed or aren't ill or aren't hurting. Think about how great that day is going to be. Perhaps this morning, we need to pray for healing for some people. Maybe there's somebody in your life that you know is struggling with a disease. I believe that God still will heal people here on earth, and that he doesn't get near as much credit and glory as he should. But at the same time, we need to ask. And so I want you to think about somebody that you can pray for healing for this morning. And then I want us to remember as we pray that sometimes our thoughts are not his thoughts and our ways are not his ways, but we still trust him. And that he's always going to heal because he said so. And God is a God of his word. Could you just think about those people? Close your eyes with me for a moment and think about somebody who maybe lives far away or maybe they're just right next to us that we want God to do something special in their bodies. Father, we ask you to heal them. Father, we have our definition of what that means. You have yours. If there's a difference between what we desire and what you desire, would you please give us the ability to understand? Would you please help us to see what you want, what you're desiring, and what the outcome here on this earth will be because of the choice that you make as the great physician? God, there are so many in our own church who wrestle with physical things today. Father, you have the ability to heal them, I know, and yet, Father, to this point, you have not. I don't understand that, but I trust you. So, God, please, more than anything, may our faith in you continue to build. May our trust in you continue to grow as each and every day, Father, we hold to this promise that you heal all of our diseases. God, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If there's anybody who would just want to spend a little bit more time after service praying about something specific, I'd be glad to sit down with you and do that. I tell you, it's been a rough week. For a lot of people, okay? We're aware of Joe's struggle with her broken wrist and just other people. There was a period of time where I got like 4 calls in one day, you know, of people just saying, hey, would you pray about this? Would you pray about that? And some of them I can't share, but I just ask you to pray for our church community and pray for those that are connected to us because it is just such an important time for the church to really show who we are. And check out that article, okay? Please check out that article. We're going to just go ahead and move into announcements now, and then we'll close the service out. Tracy, right after service today, is inviting everyone to come downstairs and help pack the shoe boxes. Some of them are on stage here as a reminder that we have a goal of 220, is that right? Boxes that we're going to fill this year and ship off to kids who are in need all around the globe. And we're also a drop-off site. And so we need people who would be willing to man that beginning next week, right, the 16th, 16th through 23rd. And so if you're willing to do that, see Tracy. She'll sign you up for a shift. And I think that'd be a great way for us to continue to support our community in those efforts as well. Rena, do I have it right? You'll take money today for Lewis Memorial, right? But today's it, okay? Any other money you want to give next week, it goes to Rena's Christmas fund, okay? So just saying. No youth group tonight, but there will be youth group next week. All of those are in your bulletin as well. And
Last thing I want to do this morning, okay, before we dismiss, is we've been praying for a while. You know, Barb needed to step out of the role of administrative assistant here at the church and be able to take more care of her dad at home and family situations and stuff. And so we tried to bless her and say thank you last week for all that she's done. Barb, again, thank you. In the meantime, we were looking for someone who could begin to fill her shoes, and God provided. Okay, and I want to introduce that person to you today. So, Maureen, would you come on up, please? Can I have your microphone? And please bring Claire with you. All righty. I'm going to introduce to you Maureen Carter and her daughter, Claire. And Maureen is going to start working at the church as our administrative assistant this week, and we look forward to that. Maureen, tell us just a little bit about yourself, okay? The high points, okay?
Yeah. I live in Edinburgh.
That's a high point?
That is a high point. I've known Tracy for, 30-some years?
She's only 25.
I know, but okay. You know. I have two daughters. This is my daughter, Claire. She's my youngest. I have another daughter who's 20, Katie. She couldn't be here this morning. I work for Springfield Clinic. That's my full-time job. And that's about it.
Interest, hobbies, anything?
Anything my kids are doing is what I do.
That's probably what you were going to say. Maureen, we are just so thankful, okay,
that you.
What you didn't mention was the highlight of life is being neighbors to...
Yes.
Bob and Becky Smith.
Okay. For 2 years.
And
I've been blessed.
And then.
A former.
Go ahead.
A former neighbor to Hank Collins.
So when she applied, guess who I called? Okay. I said, give me some dirt. Give me some news. You know, let me know what's going on. And everybody just had to say about Maureen. And so we look forward to getting her integrated. So we're going to try to have opportunities for you to get to know her. And also then for her to get to know the church and just kind of, one of her major roles is going to be that of communication, okay? And especially in social media. So, Claire, are you willing to help Mom with social media? Okay, good.
Yes, please.
Because every 13-year-old knows more about social media than any of us. And so we look forward to having that presence even expanded more than it has been, and we look forward to that. So, but there's one more thing we have to do, okay? You know what it is, don't you, Claire? Okay, good. Today is Claire's birthday, okay? So she got out of bed early. She came to church with her mom. And so I think we have to sing happy birthday to her, don't you? And so somebody who can sing, if you could start us out, please.
All right. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Claire. Happy birthday to you. Thank you for sharing it with us.
That's right. That's right. So, okay, thank you so much. All righty, I'm going to invite the worship team to come back up, and we'll dismiss. And please have a great week. Enjoy the day that God has given to us. I'll give you that back. And let's celebrate the healing that God gives to us this week. Let's sing.
We're going to sing our closing song, and it's called I'll Fly Away. Now, don't expect us to fly off the stage, but why don't you stand with us, and let's close our service today with I'll Fly Away. Some glad morning when this life is over. Fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. great week. And if you can, join us downstairs.